is Michal Tomanski. I'm a Scala developer at Virtus Lab. Today, I'd like to introduce you to the finite-state machine. Let's start with defining the problems that we have. We'd like to model a process that can have many steps. The example of such process is user registration. It doesn't always have to be a simple, you fill in the form, and voila, you got a new user. No, it may involve to do a lot of things, like you need to send him a verification email, and you have to wait until the user clicks it. Then you might need to activate his account and create some welcome discount, or maybe even award some referral points to the guy who invited him. So, yeah, such a simple process, user registration, but it might be quite complex. But another thing is that this process doesn't always have to be just step one, step two, step three. It might involve looping or condition checks, like in the online shopping. When the customer adds items to the cart, and once he's ready, he goes to checkout. Then he enters his shipping address and provides his discount code. And the happy path is that he proceeds to payment, he pays, and we can process the order. But it's not always that easy. Our customer might decide to go back and add another item. Our process needs to handle this case. And what's more, once the user adds his items, we don't want to force him to enter the discount code again, enter the shipping data. It would be a terrible user experience. We need to allow him to proceed directly to the payment. Yeah, I guess we see the problem here. We need to be able to first direct users through the process, and second, keep the data that we gather in every single step. So yeah, what is a finite state machine and how does it help here? A finite state machine is a model of a process in which we can define some steps. We can define some simple elements of the finite state machine. Of course, we've got states. A process can be in one step, in one state at a time. And along with the state, we've got data. These are simply the information that we gather in the process, in the state. But staying in one state forever is pointless. That's why we've got transitions between the states. And of course, we need to tell the process how to, when to do transitions. What is the trigger? What is the condition that we proceed from one state to another? These are the four most basic elements of the finite state machines. Now let's define a simple case study that I'll be using further in this presentation, and we'll see that working in live demo. Let me present you the express ticket machine. This is my pretty simple idea of a ticket machine that stands in the railway station and is designed for people who are in a hurry, who wants to buy the ticket for the train that departs in a couple of minutes. So the use case is as follows. You go to the train station and you walk to the machine. The machine detects your presence and it initializes and shows you the soonest connections so that you can pick the one that you want. And the machine needs to make a reservation for that connection because there will be a lot of people on the train station that wants to buy this ticket, and we have to make sure that you really get this ticket. Yeah, of course the user have to pay for this ticket and then he gets the printout. There's one crucial thing that we need to keep in mind. It's really possible that the user won't pay for the ticket, that he'll just walk away, or I don't know, he decides that it's too late for him and he'll just go home. So we need to handle the cancel the reservation if the machine times out, because we want to sell this ticket to some other guy who is at the train station. Pretty simple, but complicated enough to use the finite state machine. This is the diagram of this process. We can see I distinguished five states here. The first step is idle. And once the user comes into the machine, this let's call this create ticket machine event, this event causes the transition from idle to fetching soon as connection state. In this state, we issue a command to the to some, I don't know, soon as connection service that will receive that will give us the connections. And once we receive these connections, we can proceed to waiting for connection selection state. This is the point in which we are waiting for our user interaction. The user needs to select the connection, and the state goes to waiting for payment. And this is when the crucial thing happens. It's either payment successful or a timeout. In case of payment successful, everything goes smooth. We just print out the ticket and we can kill the process. But when the timeout happens, we need to go to fetching soon as connections. The ticket machine needs to be able to allow another user, or the same user, to pick another connection, but we need to refresh this connections list. So what tools do we have in Scala to do that? Of course, there's our favorite Akka toolkit. That's got all we need. Akka is focused on actors. An actor is a really simple being. It can receive a message, do some logic related to that message, maybe update the internal state of the actor, maybe it can reply to the sender of this message. Of course, there's a lot more about actors, but this is enough for our use case. Akka is kind enough to provide us a FSM trait, which is an actor. This trait is parameterized with two types, the state type and the data type. Here is the, it's my ticket machine FSM actor, and I provided the, here the ticket machine state super type and ticket machine data. Right now we're gonna see the state type. It's simply a trait and a several objects that are named accordingly to the diagram, and they all extend those state traits. Another thing is the data that I've mentioned before. We've got a ticket machine data trait and several objects or case classes. There are much more, but I think it's enough to show the idea. The first data is just an empty object. It doesn't have anything useful information. And then we got actual case classes with actual data in it. We've got data with origin, which includes the ID of the process and the origin station. We can also have data with connections, which holds the connections list, the soonest connections list, and so on. Once we have states and data, we need to tell the process how to initialize. Here we start with the state either and with empty data. Another cool thing is that we can describe how to make the transition from one state to another, and when to do that. We can see the pretty nice DSL of the FSM. Once we are in state either, we expect to get a create ticket machine event. And once we do that, once we get that event, we do several things. The first thing is that we create some ID of this process. It's always good to have the ID. And we proceed to another state, to fetching soon as connection state. It can be very clearly seen on this diagram. And the crucial thing that happens here is that we change the internal data of the process. We are no longer having the empty data, but now we are using data with origin, which has the ID and the origin that came from the event. This is just to show you that we don't have to always go to another state. We can as well stay in the same state and maybe just update our internal data. This is just for demo purposes. It's not really used in my code, but yeah, we can either go to another state or stay in the same state doing something. This is also a thing that I'm using here, a timeout. I defined a reservation timeout to be 20 seconds. This is the time that the machine is waiting for the user to make a payment. And yeah, we can see that in state waiting for payment, we expect to get two events. The first one can be payment successful. It's pretty trivial case, we just go to printing out tickets. This is this happy path. But the other thing is that when this timeout provided here passed, we receive the event state timeout. Akka takes care of it to send us this event, and we can handle it just as typical event. We say here that we go to fetching soonest connection state, which is this transition, and we need to substitute our data, just reset it because we have no longer the selected connection. We can also attach a logic when doing a transition from one state to another. Here we can see a handler that is fired when you go from idle state to fetching soonest connection state. Here we are just asking the connection actor to get us soonest connections from the origin that we have. This is a nice feature because we don't care here about the event that is triggering the state transition. We just care that we go from one state to another. This is especially useful when we want to have some more general logic like this. When you go from any state to idle. We can just print entering idle, or perhaps we would like to do something more, something that makes more sense. But we can also make a handler that is fired whenever we make any transition from any state to any state. Here I'm using it just for logging the transition, so that we can see that in logging in a moment. And yeah, once we set up everything, we need to initialize this process. We do that by calling initialize. This method checks if we have provided the starting data, the starting state, and it makes the initial transition. It's a fun fact that we make actually a transition from state idle to state idle. This is when these callbacks will be fired. So this is how the process starts. There's one last thing that we can do here. It's to define what to do when we don't know what to do. It may happen that we receive a create ticket machine event when we are in a state in which we don't expect to receive it. So once that happens, when our handled triggers are fired. So whenever we receive this event and we don't know what to do, we're just printing that, well, it's already created, and we just stay in the state in which we are right now. It's time for a demo. I made a play application so that we can talk to it by REST calls. And this is some Chrome plugin to make REST calls. Let's make let's compile it. And okay, we can start with executing a create ticket machine. Whoa, null pointer exception. Okay, favicon. All right. We can see in, can you see that? Yep. We can see that we're going from idle to fetching synchronous connections, and that we have successfully asked connection actor to fetch us the synchronous connections. And apparently we got back a response because we're moving from fetching synchronous connections to waiting for connection selection. So once again, it's time that I do something, and namely I can select the connection. Okay, let's see the logs. Yes, the connection is selected because we're moving from waiting for connection selection to waiting for payment. And at the same time, a reservation is made for my connection. So, yes, this is the time that the timeout happens because I wasn't quick enough to make a payment. We see that we receive timeout and the reservation is canceled. The actor moved, the state machine moved from waiting for payment to fetching synchronous connections. And the connection actor was asked once again to fetch us the synchronous connections. And once again, we receive those connections, refreshed, because we're moving from fetching synchronous connections to waiting for connection selection. Okay, let me select this connection once again and make a payment to see the happy path of it. Okay. We are going from waiting for payment to printing out tickets. It means that the payment has successful, is successful, and we have printed out the ticket. And that's all. The actor is right now stopped. We can see that by sending another message. And yes, we see that the actor has been already terminated. This is what we expected. I can also show you the unhandled event. Let me just restart it. Okay, so we start once again from creating a ticket machine. Yeah, we can see the log that we are going from idle to idle. It means that the process machine has initialized. And let me fire the create ticket machine event once again. And yes, we got the exception from play because we have a timeout on the controller. But we can see the log that the ticket machine is already created. And we don't know what to do with this event, so we're just staying in the same state. Okay, for now that's it. So how was it? What have we achieved? We created a process manager that behaves like an actor. It can talk to another actors. It's just what we want. It's the basic Akka. And I'd say that the code is pretty easy to read. It looks like a user story or like a diagram that I've shown you before. It's also easy to maintain and extend. We got a clear separation of transition logic and side effects logic. Let me skip it because I'm running low on time. There are several features that I didn't present it, like you can monitor the behavior of the ticket machine from external actors. But okay, can it be any better? Are there any problems? I'm sure you can think of a process that can go on for hours. And, well, the failure can happen. Our software can crash, our hardware can crash. A lot of things may go wrong. So, yeah, the answer is obvious. You want to make it persistent. There's this cool idea of a persistent actor. is just an actor that first saves every valid event to a journal. A journal can be, is mostly a very simple database. And the actor is doing the business logic only after the event is persisted. It's doing the crucial data changes after it's persisted. So when something bad happens, we can restart the actor, read all the events from the journal. And that's how we got our state back. We can operate as if nothing happens. One important thing that we need to keep in mind is that all that's going to happen next is experimental in Akka. This means that the API might change, or even worse, it might get removed, which might happen as well. But anyway, let's take a look at it. We've got a persistent FSM trait, which is, of course, a persistent actor. We see several changes here. The first change is that now the state type needs to extend the FSM state. We're going to see that in a moment. And last thing is that we've got now the event type. So why do we need this FSM state? While defining the state objects, we need to provide the identifier. This is just a string. It's used to persist the state changes. Why not the object name? Why don't we just serialize the object? Well, it's a very convenient way to do the state migrations via this identifier. If we need to change the logic when we are already in production, we need to take care of making it work again after we make some changes to the logic. And we're going to see that in a moment. And the crucial change is how we do the internal updates. This is how it was in the typical FSM. We just say here that when we go to another state, we're substituting the data. From now on, the internal data is data with origin. Pretty simple. But in persistent FSM, it's a bit more complicated. We don't simply substitute the data, but we say that we are applying an internal event. This is a subtype of the event trait that we've seen in the FSM trait definition. So we created an internal event, and this event is persisted in the journal. After it's persisted, only after it's persisted, it goes to apply event method. In this method, we define a logic that will transform this event, it's visible here, the domain event, and the current internal data into the new internal data. So this thing, but done in two steps. The first step being persistence, and the second state being updating the data. This is the main change here. In order to use the journal, we need to define it, and we need to find a plugin for it. There are a lot of plugins to different databases, like Cassandra, MongoDB, or in-memory journal. Here I'm using LevelDB, which is a very simple database that is working in my file system. So the only thing I need to provide here is the directory in which I'm keeping the data. Yep, demo time. So now we're gonna see exactly the same behavior, but with a possibility to have the state recovered after a failure. All right, compiling. Okay, so let's create the process. We see familiar logs. So now let me select a connection. Okay, reservation is made, but let's kill the JVM and restart it. So if everything is going how it should work, I should be able to make a payment right now, because the state should be recovered and the process should know that I've already selected a connection. So let's make a payment and see what happens. All right. As I told you before, the initial transition from the last state that is waiting for payment to itself was made. And the handler is fired that recovery completed. From now on, we have the valid state from before the crash. And the event was received. The make payment event was received. We have moved from waiting for payment to printing out tickets, and the tickets is printed out. So yes, we got our persistence. That's all we wanted to have.
May I ask a question?
Yeah.
So if I understand the logic correctly, mm-hmm. the user selected this ticket from Warsaw to Krakow at 17 o'clock, and right before he was going to pay, the system crashed.
Yes.
After it recovered, he was able to continue the payment and the ticket was printed out. Now, what if the system was down for several hours and by the time it recovered, the train has long since gone?
Well, of course, that's pretty more complicated example. And well, this is the most basic one scenario that I'm taking care of here. Of course, we need to do some more business logic to handle it. I'm just showing you the general architecture logic, that it's possible.
But yeah? The point is that the finite state machine will just roll back to the state it had before it crashed, even if the state is no longer valid by business logic, right?
Well, you're talking about two different things. The first thing is that we should do our logic. We should implement the logic in which, after the restart, we should check if the state makes sense in the environment, in the connection with other external services. We can do that as well.
Isn't this already part of your timeout? You had this in the first example.
But it's not a timeout. It's a crash. It's not a timeout.
Mm-hmm. Doesn't necessarily need to be the logic that you normally use during the state transition.
Yes, exactly.
That's the point, right?
Yes.
That's why. So you can have sophisticated checks for the train that left.
Yes, and here I'm just doing a very naive print line, recovery completed. But in real world example, we'll be using here the logic that will be checking all external services that I was talking about. And another thing that you asked is that how to make how to adjust a process to a new logic. But this is something that I will be talking, I think, just in a minute. Okay, so that's all for persistent demo. Let's go back to the presentation. So what is really persistent? The first thing is that every single internal event that is applied, and then the event goes through apply event method. And of course, every state change is also persisted. These two things goes to the journal database. And how does the recovery look like? Every single event is read one by one from the journal, from the oldest one to the newest one. And if we find a domain event, we apply it to apply event method. And if we find the state change event, we are just moving to another state. And once every single event is read from the journal, we fire the trigger from last state to last state. And we are going Oh, yeah, that's why we are seeing this lock. And we are firing up the on-recovery completed handler. And this is exactly the process that we've seen just before. Yes, exactly. Yeah, and as you've pointed out, there are several things that may go wrong. As always with persistence. But we are ready for it. When a pre-persisting failure occurs, for example, serialization error. This is everything that happens before the connection to database. Then we can provide a behavior in on-persistent rejected method. But this is a worse thing when persisting is not working. The example of such a situation is that the database is not available. It might be overloaded or it might be completely down. Then we can do several things. The first thing is that on-persist failure is called, but unconditionally, the actor is stopped. Why is that? When persisting failure happens, it's most probably the case that the database is not available. It's just overloaded. And we don't want to restart the actor and ask the database once again to recover, to fetch the journal data. Because if we had 1,000 of actors, well, this wouldn't help the database to become available once again. That's why we can define the backup strategy. It's just some random timeout that is that increases during the time and is randomized in order so that other actors don't make the calls at the same time, but they are spread evenly in the time. And the last thing is that it is up to journal when to decide that the database is not available. It's up to the plugin. So the plugin might do some internal calls. Might do some internal asks to database if it's already back or not. Yeah, and of course the recovery might fail. Once again, here we see that the actor will be stopped. Because when the recovery fails, something really bad happens. It may be the case that the business logic has changed and the state is no longer valid. Or that our data in the database is altered or deleted. So we really don't know what to do and the actor is not able to be restarted. There are also several minor traps here, like we have to be really careful with killing the actor. It's not a good idea to do something like this because the poison pill might be handled before this event is handled. If the persistent actor is busy with persisting other events, this message will be stashed, but the poison pill will be handled by Akka itself and kill our actor. So this will not work as it's expected. Oh yeah, another thing that we need to be aware of is that all the events that are sent to during recovery are sent by dead letters. So if we really need to persist want to have the sender, the original sender of the message, we need to persist its actor path along with the event. Okay, and the worst part about persistent FSM is that it's not really good in evolving. There might be event schema evolution when we just need to adjust an event, like add another field to the case class or remove it or just rename it. But this is pretty simple. It's handled by either the serialization plugin itself or via event adapters. Here we can define methods that will alter, upcast our event from the previous version to the new version. We can just override the method to journal or from journal. But another not so trivial thing is when our FSM logic changes. I think this is something that clearly pictures what it is about. We can run our state machine through steps 1 to 3, and we can change something, like remove a transition from state 2 to state 3. It's no longer correct from the business perspective to go from state 2 and state 3. And when something bad happens and we need to restart the reactor, well, the transition will be made because the events in the journal says that, hey, it's correct to go from state 2 to state 3. We don't have that check. And the question is if we should have this check here or not. I think it's up to the process itself, and we need to define this logic by ourselves. Okay, so why is it good, to sum up, why is it good to have a persistent FSM? Of course, it gives us persistence. This is what we want. And it's also a good start for event sourcing or command query responsibility separation, because we have we can persist events, and it's a good start to make them go to another database to do the query side. But the downsides, I think these two that I've provided you just before. The schema changes and the logic changes. Well, it's awesome, but I think you can see the one downside that we have here. I'm still talking about having only one ticket machine. What if we want to migrate this ticket machine to the server and allow several users to access it? Well, here we go into the cluster sharding. We need to be able to maintain a lot of persistent actors. But it's a topic for another conference speech, I think. So thank you very much. In case any of you would like to go back to this presentation, you can find the slides here and the call from live demo here. And you can catch me on Twitter. Are there any questions?
There's time for one question.
Okay, one question. Yeah?
In the finite state actor, there are two possible places to do business logic. Mm-hmm. When you receive an event and when there's a transition from one state to another. What is your opinion the best place to do business?
I'd say that they might be two types of logic. The first one is the logic that is required to determine what the transition is and what the event is to be applied. So this should go into the when method. And the other thing, like asking external actors to do something, should go into the on transition triggers. This is what I was always doing, and I find it pretty clear. Okay, thank you.